So I'm very happy to be here and to introduce Katie Yamasaki. Probably it looks like you have many friends here, but I will read the bio anyway. Katie is an artist based in Brooklyn, New York. She works primarily as a muralist, community artist, and children's book illustrator. Her work has enabled her to travel and create visual dialogues with children in Cuba, Namibian teens, Japanese auto manufacturers, and indigenous women inmates fighting for gender equality and nonviolence within the prisons of Chiapas, Mexico. Because of the earthquake which just happened in Japan, let's take a second and hopefully we hope that Japan fully recovers and there are not too many more people who have been disabled or affected by the earthquake. Katie's public projects have explored topics that range from the Japanese internment to Appalachia's economic crisis to tribalism among Namibian youth. She's worked on a collaborative mural project with members of the Zapatista Army for National Liberation in Chiapas and most recently completed public projects in Cypress Hills, Brooklyn, Barcelona, and Sevilla, Spain. For years, Katie has led a public art program for young women called Voices Heard, where teen girls address critical issues in the form of large-scale public art. She teaches to fourth and eighth grade students at Ballet Tech, the New York City Public School for Dance. Katie earned her Master's of Fine Arts from the School of Visual Arts and currently has illustrated two published books, Honda, The Boy Who Dreamed of Cars, and Lifelines, The Black Book of Proverbs. She is currently working on Fish with Jimmy, her first published book, as both author and illustrator with Holiday House Books. It is the story of two brothers in the Japanese internment camps of World War II. And as you can see by her studio drawings, which are really wonderful, we hope maybe she can do a mural for Ari. Okay, now it's the night. We will give it to Katie Yamasaki. Let's give her a big hand.
Thank you for all for coming, and thank you to Ari for having me. This is going to be a very casual, this is not going to be a lecture. I've slept through many kind of slideshows throughout art school, and I don't want to do that to everybody here. So the room is full of, right now, people who are actors and teachers, and they're lawyers and designers, and the idea of social and professors and all different kinds of people in all different mediums and careers. And the idea of social transformation, it's not as if art is the, or public art is the one piece of that puzzle. So what I hope is that everybody in kind of all of these different professions and with all this different expertise will kind of engage in more of a dialogue than just a lecture. Please. So I'm going to just start out with some major themes that my work addresses. And a lot of you, I know so many of you who I'm looking at right now, so a lot of you know that largely my work works on women's and children's issues and kind of always has since the beginning. And so what I'm going to go through now is just some other themes. Identity is always a big piece. And do you think, should we turn off some of these lights or can you guys see okay? It's okay? Maybe that's a little better. I'm going to go through, what I'm going to do is kind of go through, that's better, right? No sleeping. I'm going to go through some of the themes and then I'm going to go back and discuss project by project. But identity, public art kind of has a way of taking an organization or an individual and providing them a format to kind of describe themselves for an organization to kind of express what their identity is or develop their identity. So I've kind of been traveling around a lot in different parts of the country where maybe groups haven't had the opportunity to communicate who they are to the broader public. It often feels like the main people who have their identities kind of seared into our public consciousness are corporations. And so this is an opportunity for schools and individuals and community organizations to do this. So I'm going to go back into these projects individually. This is one I'm working on right now, but and this has to do with the identity of teachers. Voice is another one. That voice is another major theme that's kind of gone through the last 8 years or so. I've been working with groups of teenage girls, and the idea is to provide voice to people who may not otherwise, to people who are often spoken for rather than listened to. Also, this is in a homeless shelter in Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn, and Santiago de Cuba. I'd just like to recognize right now this project that I'm going to go into a little bit more is kind of thanks to one member in the audience, Mauricio, who kind of started an interchange between a lot of artists in Brooklyn and New York and Santiago. Our resistance is also something that I'm trying to work on a little bit more in terms of supporting resistance movements. This is in Barcelona. This was pretty recent. And I think that public art in this case has the ability to support a resistance movement and also to get people who are not necessarily part of the kind of, if you're preaching to the choir, a lot of the time when you are part of a movement, the people who are in your audience are already people who believe the same thing. And muralism, because of its public nature, has the ability to draw in people who may not necessarily either be for your movement or against your movement, and it can have a way of pulling people in. Education, this is at Acorn High School. I'm going to also share with you some work that my students have done at Ballet Tech. One way that I've been working on, specifically in education, is to provide opportunities for youth to engage with nature, because a lot of the time it feels like for kids in the city, environment is a very abstract concept, and one way to kind of connect them more with nature is to and to get them to care about it is something more than abstract, is to connect them with animals. So these three, globalization, displacement, and environment, I know they're huge topics, but I've kind of been linking them together, and did that in Spain and also in Chiapas, and again here in New York. So these are all, this says in Spanish, it says no person is illegal. That's in Spain. So those are the kind of the main, oh, and this is the other one, politically relevant historical work. This is this is really specific to one topic for me at this point, and it's it has to do with the Japanese internment and then our society post 9/11, and kind of what happened with the Japanese Americans, and then what's happening and what's happened to Arab Americans and the Islamic population in the United States since 9/11, and really in a lot of United States and Europe. So this is something that I'll talk a little bit more about later. And uplift. I think that always the hope is that with art, more than with a lot of other types of work, what you hope is that it can actually change the way people feel when they look at it. So it's not just, this is in a prison in Mexico. And so it's not, you don't necessarily just want to affect the way people think and the way people make their, or just kind of process things intellectually, but actually reach the way and change the way that people feel. So I'm going to talk a little bit about my background and kind of how I got into all this. This is me when I was like 4 or 5, I think. And I thought that this was me painting, but I'm actually cleaning brushes. So I think I probably painted with just one brush at a time. But I was really a creative kid. I didn't study art formally for a really long time, but I did grow up near one of Diego Rivera's best murals in Detroit. And I'm not just saying that, he said that too. So, but this was a place that we went to often, but I never grew up thinking that I would be an artist. I kind of thought I would do something in social justice, but not art, because I didn't really draw. I did a lot of paper mache, and I sewed, and I baked, and did a lot of making things, but I didn't know how to draw, and I didn't know how to paint. And then one thing that really affected my kind of mindset in terms of thinking about what I wanted to do when I grew up was the fact that our family was interned during World War II. This is a picture of the Japanese internment camps of my great-grandparents and my great-aunt, my grandmother's sister. My grandparents at that time were in New York City, so they were not interned. But knowing that that happened and knowing that in my entire high school experience, it was never talked about. Like the internment was just, it just never happened according to the teachers in my school. So the anniversary of Pearl Harbor would come around and they'd ask me what happened on that day, because they would want me to remind the class of you know, the tragedy of Pearl Harbor. And where we grew up was very anti-Japanese climate because it was the 80s and it was the recession and it was GM town. So there was a GM factory in our town, and everybody worked there. It was 1982 when they killed a Chinese guy named Vincent Chin because they thought he was Japanese. And so the environment was pretty hostile towards Japanese people, and that that kind of motivated a lot of my thinking, but I didn't necessarily know that it would motivate my artwork later on because I didn't have any plans on becoming an artist. So it was politicizing from a very young age. This is Ed Young is here, actually. I'm so happy that he's here. When I got to college, I had a really great opportunity to work with Ed Young and study with Ed Young, who was an amazing teacher for me, and I'm so happy that he's here right now. This was kind of my junior year of college when I was just trying to figure out what do you do with your life if you want to do something meaningful, if you want to be involved in kind of social justice work. And I tried studying to be like a social worker, but I hated the classes. It was really painful for me to sit through those classes, and I loved drawing. And I wasn't good. Paul was actually in my first drawing class, I think, and I was I had no training, and I drew how like my seventh graders draw now. So when I see their drawings, I'm like, you draw how I drew in college. But when I went to study with Ed, I still felt like I was very far behind because a lot of people went to really kind of special high schools who came to my college, and they had studied in these art programs and gone to like art camp and stuff like that. And I was definitely not at that level, but I liked doing it so much that I just kind of decided I would stick with it. My parents, I had a long conversation with them, and the idea was if this is what I want to do, or this is what I like to do, but I want to do something that will be positive, like make some kind of positive contribution or be engaged politically. And they said, if you do what you love, then you'll be most effective. And that was a really important thing for me to hear at that time, and it kind of gave me permission to kind of pursue this because I wasn't interested in the fine art world at all. The gallery world didn't appeal to me. It continues to not appeal to me that much, but I didn't really know what else to do. So when I met Ed, my job was, I stayed with him and his daughter, one daughter at that time, was to archive his, at that time he had like over 80 books for children. So I went through all of his work from the very beginning, the rough sketches through the finishes, and saw his whole process over and over again, and I cataloged it for University of Connecticut. They were taking it to their archives. And just seeing that process and kind of seeing things evolve, it made me have peace with my own process and peace with the fact that like I always felt way behind, and I always felt like my drawings were the worst ones up on the wall, and so I just kept going with it. And I was at Earlham College in Richmond, Indiana, and I started to do a lot of collage, which was also heavily influenced by Ed. And I continued with collage and with the theme of the internment. This was my great-grandfather who was interned. I made a book about his internment, which was based on letters that my grandmother and her sister wrote back and forth. My grandmother was in New York, and her sister was interned in Amache, Colorado. And so I kind of told the story of the internment through these letters. And that was my graduation project. And then I ended up at the School of Visual Arts. I'm going to go back to that last slide. But at School of Visual Arts, I was studying with Marshall Erisman, who's also here. I'm very happy that my teachers are here. And I think I was 25, and I still hadn't learned to paint. And I was loving collage, but I was also completely using it as a crutch. I hadn't even considered doing murals because when you draw and do collage, it's not even like in your possibility range. So, but in this project in particular, the image on the right, I was doing things like, instead of just painting, I was doing things like cutting out 80 oranges and then gluing them on and cutting out like 50 tomatoes. And we were in a critique, and I felt like the collage kind of made me special because nobody else was doing it. And Marshall said, you have to learn how to paint. And I said, this looks so nice. This is like my this is like my thing. And but I did. I eventually agreed, and I learned how to paint. And I ended up with the Leo and Diane Dillon as my thesis advisors. which is also a huge blessing. And I worked with them this second year of graduate school and then continued to kind of work with them. And they really value craft and they value kind of learning your technique. So I did start studying painting, and I did this. This was my first painting project. It was about a mambo dancer from Haiti. And what was funny about this was people were always saying, like, oh, you know, you paint so naive, you know, and naive as if it's, you know, people value that in the fine art world. Like, it's, they've got art site or out fairs for people who are painting, you know, in this naive style. But it was just that I didn't know how. So, like, this is what my paintings looked like, and I liked them. But it was funny to be put into that box, because it's kind of like when people travel to the Caribbean and they want to buy these naive paintings. That's what they look for, people who are untrained. And I'm in a master's program at the School of Visual Arts, and so people think I'm doing it on purpose, but no. And this was my first painting project, and I loved it. And so when I graduated, getting a master's in fine art is different than getting like a law degree or an IT degree, because nobody knows what they're going to do then. So you have an MFA, and I started applying to more graduate schools because I didn't know what else to do. I was teaching Pilates, and you know, you're just thinking like, what am I going to do with all of this? So my friend Paul, his mom invited me to come and paint a mural on her library. And I had never, since I just learned how to paint like a year before, I had never even thought about doing anything big in public, but she was so nice about it that I decided I would kind of go for it. And I really loved, I loved the scale, and I loved the interaction with the people who worked at the school. The kids weren't there, it was in the summertime, but just working with the custodians and with the administrators and the teachers and just kind of being out in the world. I was really reluctant. Another reason I was reluctant to ever study art is because it seemed like a very lonely career to me, and I didn't want to just be in the studio by myself all the time, and so this seemed like a good solution. I went on to Detroit to do a mural at this African-centric school as my second project. And after that dedication, working with those kids, this was a school that is in the middle of a neighborhood where every street that surrounds the school is either an abandoned building or an empty lot. And the whole time I was working, which a lot of that time was over a vacation, the custodian was with me and she was armed the whole time because the neighborhood was so rough. And but the school itself and the kids at the school were really thriving. So when I went back for the dedication, they had made a play that was based on the mural, and they had also composed a song based on the poem that was written around the outside of the mural, which is a poem by Mark Scarvey. And that at that moment, I was kind of like, okay, this is something I should continue to find a way to do. After 9/11, I started thinking a lot about loss of rights, loss of civil rights, and loss of civil liberties. And I went back to my college to paint. They invited me to come back because the Quakers, it was a Quaker school, and the Quakers had been very involved in getting the Japanese out of the internment camps. And at Earlham in particular, they had gotten a lot of students out of the internment camps to come to school there. And I was trying to figure out, and I'm still kind of working in this mindset of how to connect what happened at that time to what's happening right now with the Muslim population in the United States and abroad in terms of loss of rights. So in particular, because when 9/11 happened, one thing that was really hard for me and hard for our family was that my grandfather, some of you probably know, my grandfather was the chief architect of the World Trade Center, and to have that building be turned into something that was like pro-war and anti-Islam was really against like our family values. So, and it got completely used for that. So now the question is kind of how to counteract that a little bit in any way that I can. And this is kind of like an ongoing thought that I have. Back in Detroit, when I was kind of, I think there was a year or two where I worked like every day, and these were these small murals that I was kind of working every day and going from one project to the next. This is the Detroit Catholic Pastoral Alliance, and they have a preschool, a wonderful preschool, and they had just kind of invited me to come in and do a project for their new center. And so If I'm stuck of where to start, I'll start with a poem. And this poem, The Dreamkeeper by Langston Hughes, was so perfect. Bring me all of your dreams, you dreamer. Bring me all your heart melodies that I may wrap them in a blue cloud cloth away from the two rough fingers of the world. And for that population, it seemed very perfect. And this mural is about 19 feet wide. So it's pretty big, and it was just kind of like this. I'd always taught. I'd often been a teacher. I'd been a teacher for 2 years before that, full time. And so it was so nice to be around all of these kids, and not be responsible for them, but to be able to just be with them. They would come out and talk to me. And this was the woman who was the head of Southeast Detroit Head Start. I'm trying to, in my own work, in the book work and in the mural work, have a balance between doing stuff that's heavily political and also just stuff that if I were a kid that I would find really engaging and that I kind of, that's very spirited, to just have a balance. This is in Manhattan, Manhattan Comprehensive Night and Day High School. And this one I actually painted at my studio. The Voices Heard series, if you live in Brooklyn, you may have seen some of these. Kind of goes on several principles. It was started, officially started in 2004, and I started running it at that time. And the idea is to provide young women, particularly young women of color, the opportunity to be the creators of the visual media about them. So they come up with the ideas of what they want to explore, and then they create the imagery and collaboratively. And Groundswell's been running that, and it was as a result of a project that had happened years prior when a mural painted by all girls had gotten, it was about domestic violence, and it had gotten painted over. The girls had wanted to communicate a message about domestic violence, and it was, the neighborhood wasn't ready for it. It was in Park Slope, and it was all young women of color, and it was about a topic that the residents of Park Slope felt did not affect them. And so there was a lot of community controversy. The girls had painted the mural, and then in the middle of the night, Rite Aid caved, and they painted it. They whitewashed the whole thing. So that kind of politicized the girls who were involved, and then Groundswell kind of decided to make it a formal program. We choose a topic that's relevant, both locally and globally, and then we use a kind of different approach, a creative approach and a physical approach to teach all of these things: research, analysis, drawing, grading, painting, public speaking, collaboration, and community relations. A lot of these drawings, especially the ones that look like they've been through a lot, they are the drawings from Voices Heard projects. It also is, it's amazing when you provide young women a space where they can develop their own sense of artistry, their sense of self, their physical self, their artistic self. When you provide them that space outside of male expectation, how much they can evolve in the time length of a summer or of a year, and then some girls just keep coming back. So this is Groundswell's website if you want to see more of their work, because they do amazing work all over the city. This was the first year, and this was they had wanted to hire somebody with experience, because it was this big wall on 4th Avenue and Sackett, and it was going to be, it's complicated scaffolding. We had to take a ladder up the side of the wall, and then scaffolding was on top of that other roof. And I had never worked on scaffolding. I'd never done an outdoor mural, but they couldn't find anybody else, so they gave it to me, which I was really scared about. I lost a lot of sleep that summer because I had no idea. I didn't know about gridding, and even when we did the grid, like the there were some major mistakes. Like you can't see it here, but there's a bolt, a giant bolt that comes out of the central figure's eye, and stuff like that that just happened as a learning process. But this project, you know, was interesting because aesthetically there were certain things about it that when the scaffolding came down, I had so many anxiety dreams when the scaffolding was still up, and like that it was going to come down and half of it wasn't painted. And when it came down, you know, there were things aesthetically that I was disappointed in. And then when we had the dedication and the girls spoke and the community members spoke, it kind of gave me a better understanding of what this is about. And just murals are a good exercise in letting go of your ego, because it's not actually about you at all. You're kind of like the vehicle for what the youth or what the community needs to express. And so that was a good learning experience. And then as far as like designing a mural, with youth who are inexperienced painters, it's a good exercise, and this was a good exercise in designing components of the image where a painter of any level could work for 7 weeks, or well, really for 4 weeks, 3 weeks of planning and then 4 weeks of painting. So that's why the wall is painted brick. It's actually cement wall. And you know, lots of, and then there are small painting lessons like highlights to shadows and stuff like that. Very simple painting lessons all over the wall, and that came up a lot. If you have any questions or comments or anything during, please feel free to call out. This is in Prospect Heights. This is the site of Key Food. Brooklyn Museum is like two blocks that way up Washington. And that's this drawing right here. This was in collaboration with the Brooklyn Museum. They had just acquired the Dinner Party by Judy Chicago, and they had just built the Sackler Center for Feminist Art, which is the only center for feminist art in the country. There are center for women, there's centers for women's art, but this is like politically the only center for feminist art. So we kind of aesthetically, in terms of the waves and some of the textiles we were using, were reflecting that piece. But the girls' main complaint with the Dinner Party was that it kind of looked at feminism as if it were a white woman's movement. And because most of the women at the Dinner Party, if you haven't seen the piece, it's this giant, giant triangle, like with ceramic place settings, with the idea being that throughout great dinner parties in history, it has always been men who've been invited to the dinner parties and not women. So, in a lot of primarily the women of color who are at that particular dinner party, there's a different place setting for each woman, were mythological. So, the girls in the group were looking at different women that they would invite to their dinner party, including themselves. And then they looked at different weavings and handicrafts kind of from around the world that are typically considered women's work, which was a big piece of what the dinner party was. So they just took that billboard down like last year, and now they're like, would you have more of that gold? This was 2005 or something, so they want us to go back. Another part of the Voices Heard program has always been interviewing and teaching the girls how to ask questions. Part of it is like the idea of teaching them how to learn. And one thing that we usually like to do is to do some kind of interview or community survey. So the following year we were at PS24, which is in Sunset Park, and it's a bilingual school, mostly Spanish and English, but there's also a significant Chinese population in that community. And so the girls drafted an interview for the mothers of the school, because that was at a time when immigration was, there were a lot of protests, and it was kind of a hot topic politically, it still is, but that was kind of the first wave of protest marches. So the girls also worked at interviewing their mothers about issues that they hadn't really spoken to them about. And this mural just kind of addressed the entire immigration journey that was reflected to us. And it was interesting because I remember the last day of this project, or one of the last days, I had been working there all day. It was probably like 6 o'clock, and it was 110 degrees, and it's Fourth Avenue right at the BQE, and it's really hot and really gross. And this guy comes, and he's like maybe a 40-year-old white man, and he said, I really feel like underrepresented in this mural. And I was like, well, he said, I feel like my voice wasn't taken into account, and you're making immigration look really hard. And so so it's like one of those conversations where you're like, I have to have this conversation. You have to, you engage in every conversation. And any other muralists here right now are kind of laughing because they've had like that conversation, but maybe a slightly different twist. But and it's interesting because it's as a, my thought was, well, you could, as a white man, if you feel underrepresented, you can just turn on TV or open up a book or a newspaper or a magazine or go to the library or go to the movies or like you're everywhere, But he was also upset that, he was upset that there wasn't like a, what he felt was a community presence. But what it made me realize, because there was a huge community presence in this, what it made me realize is, and this has kind of helped me develop a thicker skin, because when you work on the street, you kind of have odd encounters with people all the time, but that you have to just have a thicker skin for dealing with people, like who there will always be dissenting opinions, and that's fine. and not everybody needs to like it. And that's kind of my response lately. It's okay if you don't like it. This is on the side of PS 295 MS 443 in Park Slope, New Voices. And this was an opportunity to have the girls, you know, we always want them represented in the mural, but to actually have them physically represented in the mural. The big complaint is that young women and young women of color are almost never the creators of the visual media about them. Usually it's somebody at an advertising agency or at some kind of firm who's quite out of touch with the actual group of people that they're representing. So this time we had the actual faces of the girls in the painting. And what was interesting was the principal from that school, after the mural was done and the scaffolding came down, she was walking up the street and somebody said behind her, in conversation with somebody else, like, well, the mural looks nice, but it's just odd that they didn't put any American girls in there. And you think, like, this is like 2007 or whenever, 6, 7, and this is Brooklyn, and that's like a shocking statement, but it kind of is a reminder of why these projects have to happen and why people's kind of collective imagination needs to be stretched. This is funny. See those UPS? This was the most graffiti that our murals have ever gotten. Before the dedication, somebody climbed up those pipes and stuck those UPS envelopes on the people. I didn't realize they were there until I was just looking through the slideshow a minute ago. This mural has gotten probably the most attention of that series. It was at a time when a lot of the girls were being very harassed by military recruiters. With No Child Left Behind, the government released the telephone numbers of teenagers to military recruiters. So starting around 15 or 16, the girls and other kids have been getting calls at their home to enlist in the military, in this case for Iraq. And so at that time, about half of the girls in the group, about 6 of them, were thinking of joining the military because they thought, how else am I going to pay for college? And so when that came up, we thought, you know, maybe this should be the topic of the mural because, you know, what military recruiters tell you is one thing, and then what actually might happen is something else. So we partnered with Iraq Veterans Against the War, Service Women's Action Network, American Friends Service Committee, and a couple other groups. And they sent in some veterans to speak with the girls, and within like a half an hour of kind of hearing veterans' stories, all of the girls had changed their minds, and they were just like, okay, I'll find another way to pay for college. And it was so simple, but it's something that just doesn't happen that much. The recruiters can be so powerful. So their statement was, we are not government issued. It said, arm yourself. The drawing for that one is over there, and then the grid. Arm yourself with the knowledge to think for yourselves. We are not government issued. And then in the parachute, it says, keep illegal war out of and our bodies, our neighborhoods, our futures, our humanity. And then under the parachutes are a lot of statistics in the shadows. There are a lot of statistics that are related especially to veteran care, homeless veterans, alcoholism, education, and kind of like the truth about the pay that you'll get as a first-year military person, the truth about college loans and money for college, tuition reimbursement, and things like that that the recruiters push on you, and then kind of the other side of that. So for a lot of people, and also just statistics about the war and about our tax dollars, and for a lot of people, this mural was really popular, but the people who lived in that neighborhood, they didn't know, they didn't come to the public viewing of the design. So when the scaffolding came off, they were really shocked and not happy for the most part. They saw this and they thought it was a construction site, which is funny because it's all teenage girls working up there, so I don't know what I don't know what they thought we were doing. But when it came down, there was a group of kind of resistors at the dedication, and they were saying things like, it makes our neighborhood look anti-American, and somebody said, why don't you draw something pretty, like somebody jogging in the park, which, but one really, like, poignant conversation that came from that was, one woman was talking, One friend of mine, her son, after being in the service, committed suicide, and she was there in support of the mural. And then another woman came up and she said, my son just got back from Iraq. I don't want him to have to read this stuff. You know, it's statistics about, like, homelessness and about depression and alcoholism and just stuff that's kind of, you have to look into the mural to find it, but it's there, you know, and there are statistics that the general population need to know about. And the other woman was just like, you need to, you know, your son needs to know these things. And so it's kind of like one of these dialogues that that don't really happen. And I think that's one of my favorite things about doing these murals is it brings people together in a way that doesn't otherwise happen on the street. People don't typically just stand around and talk. They kind of brings people together in a different way. So I don't, you know, in the end, the mural, it hasn't been tagged, it hasn't been touched, and it just stayed there. Their resistance died down, but I guess, you know, you just hope that that as painful as, like, seeing other sides of a story might be, that it can save people from certain, from becoming one of those statistics. This is in Bed-Stuy. This is, this was probably the worst wall I've ever painted physically. It's like when you look at a wall and it has metal windows, security cameras, lights, like all of that stuff on there, and then the quality of the brick was like the roughest grade of sandpaper, you're in trouble. But that was this wall, but actually it was a wonderful project. 101 homeless women lived there, and it's next door to, like, brand new luxury lofts, across the street from luxury lofts that were being developed, diagonal from other luxury lofts that were all empty. And then in the homeless shelter, there are 101 women trying to transition into housing. And so the girls in the group, for a lot of them, they hadn't worked with any kind of homeless population before. So they were really surprised to kind of, when they interviewed the women who lived there, to kind of learn that, like, homeless doesn't necessarily define you, and also that they don't all look like the people that you see on the street or on the train. They look like people that you see in an office or at your school or whatever. So it was pretty eye-opening. Our topic was actually health and health and education, and the kind of under the umbrella topic of poverty. So but when we created that image, we had been researching those topics during the school year, and when we created the image, we wanted it to be related to the population of BRC, Bowery Residence Committee. This is the BRC staff and then our Voices Heard team. So we kind of made it be more of a image about metamorphosis. So the women were kind of painted like rocks at the bottom that were kind of breaking out of that. And the gesture of the figure is an Egyptian gesture for offering, and then the water is a symbol, also in Egyptian art, for rebirth. And then the two figures that are standing on the hands of the central figure have quotes from the United, the International Declaration of Human Rights, one about education, or I mean one about health and one about housing. So this was the brightest wall I've ever worked on. There are no trees on that block. With all that luxury housing, there are no trees. And so that wall will fade quickly, so we painted it kind of extra dark. Yeah. There's a whole curriculum design. So the program with the girls is 7 weeks long. And the first 3 weeks, we're in the process of researching. So the research process starts during the school year. And so the research process involves, like, gathering actual information, bringing in guest speakers, and informing ourselves about the topic as much as possible after we've chosen the topic collectively. And then the drawing process, like, the curriculum involves a lot of writing and a lot of drawing. Not all the girls are artists, but developing symbols. And what happens is, throughout the course of the workshops that we do, I'll end up with a pile of drawings and writings and just different kinds of visual information, symbols that they're interested in, and I'll put it into one big drawing. And then we go back and forth. And a lot of the time, they actually we'll do a lot of that big drawing, and then I'll kind of refine it a little bit, because the idea is to have it look like it's 14 people painting as one hand versus, like, 14 people all over the place. And but the image is, like, the symbolism is always developed by the girls, or kind of cultivated by the girls. And then often the actual poses, I've got, like, pictures of the girls. If you look at the they're curled up. They'll do drawings of each other in the positions that are going to show up in the mural later on. So they're really integral in the design process. This was most recent. It's in Cypress Hills, way out on the J train. This one is about consumerism and our relationship to our material goods, and then how that links us to women in other parts of the world who are making them, and how our identities are kind of created based on a lot of the things that we consume, and then what the global consequences are of all of that. So across this mural is a quote from Martin Luther King: "I'm convinced that if we are to get on the right side of the world revolution, we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, militarism, and materialism and militarism are incapable of being conquered." So consumerism has often been looked at kind of like as a women's, you know, kind of a women's issue, you know, body image and all of that. And that is a part of it, but it's also a political issue in terms of with all of the things that we need with our cell phones and our cars and our whatever, where are all those things coming from whose land are they coming from, who's making them and under what conditions? And most of the time it's young women just like me and the girls in the group. So we were kind of researching that last summer. So that's Voices Heard for the, that's kind of been a big, that's been every summer for the last 8 years. And in the meantime, during the rest of the year, I've been doing a lot of traveling. I went to Tennessee a couple years ago, and it wasn't necessarily a place that I had sought out. It's like rural Appalachia, but I was really interested in going when I got invited. And a random arts council in Crossville got a grant from the state and from the county. So they had me come down, and I kind of took a look around and met a lot of people and took a lot of pictures. And you know, it was kind of like at that time, people in that area, they told me in the interviews what they wanted me to know. The mural is next door to these guys. This is the barber shop, and the mural is right next to it. So when I got there, it was really interesting because these were my neighbors, and on the other side of the mural, between there's the barber shop and then me and then the cowboy shop. So it was really different, more different than going to Mexico or different than going to wherever. Crossville was a whole different world for me. And when I got there, though, I thought, like, okay, this is going to be kind of simple because everybody's white, everybody's working class or poor working class, everybody's Christian. You know, it seemed like a group, like the most homogenous group I'd ever really seen. But as I kind of worked on the project, this is across the mirror. You can see the mirror reflected in the window. This is like an old-fashioned soda counter where all the World War II veterans would sit and like watch me paint while they drank coffee all day. And they would come across and talk. But, you know, it was really interesting because I thought that, you know, you don't really know what a society that homogenous would feel like, but then in no way would they ever consider themselves homogenous. It was kind of like the Baptists are here, the Catholics are here, the Pentecostals are here. And I thought that was really interesting. Even the Rotary clubs, like there were three Rotary clubs and they didn't really get along well with each other. Like I had to do like three different Rotary presentations because the Rotary was at odds. So it was a really interesting place to spend. I spent almost 2 months there, and the people were very generous. They gave me, like, the first week I had house keys to, like, three different places and business keys if I ever got cold. And but what I realized with this project was the mural that I painted, you know, the mural that I painted was really based on what they told me in the beginning and, you know, their pride and kind of their military service and their, they had a big WPA housing project there and their church culture and their natural life and agriculture. But in their music and mining. But so that was when I first went. I learned all of that and I did all the designs. And there are a bunch of the drawings from that mural that are kind of around the room. And so I had to take those drawings, like when I first got down there, like the first night, to the local courthouse. And there was this jury full of the county commission, which was like these guys from the mountains, and they sat in the jury, and I gave them the drawings and I presented like my ideas from the initial interviews. And they were fine with that. But after I started working on the mural, the kind of the shell broke a little bit on the culture of Crossville, Tennessee, and people started to be very honest with me about what life was like down there for them. And not saying that it was terrible, but that the reality of Tennessee, of Appalachia is, and I knew this, but it's like you can't put words in people's mouths. When they tell you, when you interview somebody, they tell you what they tell you, and it's not up to you to just switch that around into like what you've read in some study. Like, actually, really, I heard you're not happy here because, you know, you can't do that. So, but as, you know, it just got a lot more complex, and that's what I found with every project, is that people tell you what they, how they, I think it's almost like how they imagine their world to be, or how they imagine they, what they imagine they can go back to. But the actual reality of the school system, the taxation system, like the drug, the meth problem, I had like recovering meth addicts helping me on this project, and the lack of health care available for the veterans. Like, Tennessee has the highest volunteerism for the military in the country, and the way that the veterans down there are kind of suffering was really eye-opening. And so from this I decided, and this is a very slow starting project, that I'm gonna do like a series of follow-up paintings. The painting of the mural that the people want in their community, and then the painting that I kind of want to do, because people come and tell you all of these stories, and then you're like, okay, what do I do with this now? Because it does not, like, you already approved this design, so that becomes a little, and there's no space. This family was kind of like the perfect example of it. They were so wonderful, and the tall boy, Alex, he was one of the best helpers the whole time. He was a high school student. His mom worked in the cafeteria at another school where her younger son went. The mom couldn't get enough hours at the cafeteria, so they had no health care. They lived like an hour outside in deep into the mountains, so they couldn't, like, she couldn't, Alex wouldn't take the bus home because he wanted to work on the mural, so she would just come and stay until the sun went down after working so that Alex had the opportunity to work on the mural. And her son, she also didn't want to send her son home on the bus because he was being harassed. He was being bullied by a kid whose parents ran a meth lab out of their home, and there was nothing that the police were going to do back in those mountains because it is apparently a whole nother system of law out there. So like what, they had a whole, you know, it was a different, but they didn't tell me that when I first came to design the mural, like the first weekend, you know, those things come out over time. So it kind of merits another project. Oh, okay. This is a project, Santiago de Cuba. I don't know, Mauricio, how long has this been going on, Internos? This 15 years? So for 15 years, every other year in Santiago de Cuba, they have a group of artists come from all over, mostly North America, South America, and Europe, for the most part, to participate in a mural event where people bring their own work and kind of share their own work and then paint a collaborative project. And this was my first time going to Cuba, and the experience was really, you know, it was really transformative. The actual process of working with like 16 artists on one mural was really interesting and a little bit crazy, but like and visually also totally insane. But as you can see, you can see where every artist stops. This is what we try to avoid in Voices Heard, where it's like he was here and she was here and she was here. But yeah, I know you can see mine. But anyway, it was kind of another one of those moments where you're like, this is bigger than the aesthetic of the project. And when I was there, I had left the school I've been teaching at Ballet Tech, which is the New York City Public School for Dance, since 2000. I started in 2000 as a Spanish teacher there, and then I took 2 years to go back to grad school. And when I was in Cuba, my students were with a guest artist, and they were really curious about Cuba. You know, a lot of them are from the Caribbean, or their parents are from the Caribbean, and so when I came back, they were full of questions about, you know, what is Cuba like, what are the kids like. And while I was in Cuba, they had invited me to come and have an exhibit. And it was a really funny process, like thinking about the art world in New York. We were painting at the mural, and one of the guys said, Katie, you should have a show here. And I was like, well, that would be so fun. So he said, do you have your portfolio? And I did. I had my book. So he's like, well, let's go. So we went, and we were like head to toe paint and sweat and dirt, and we walked out onto the street, which is not how Cuban people dress. They're very well put together. And we went to the gallery, and I showed the director my book, and she said, "Oh, this is great. You know, how about April 2007? And I was like, okay. So I went back, and this is just, that would never ever, at least not to me, that would never happen here in New York. Maybe I'm sure it would happen to some other people. But when I got back, I wanted to engage my students in the show, because with Cuba, there's so much political baggage when it comes to adults, you know, and you can't, you know, people feel guilty, people feel like, you know, allegiances to things that they might not necessarily know the complete picture for. And like, I couldn't create this new body of work ignoring the fact that, like, I live in the United States and this is a show in Cuba. But I felt like the most real dialogue that I could have with the work would be between my students and their peers in Cuba. So I had my students write postcards to kids in Cuba describing who they are and what their life is like in New York. And then I did paintings of them. And the idea was that there's so many people who speak for kids. Wait, you see his shirt. Yes, does your face hurt? It's because it's killing me. When I painted him, he saw the shirt and he was like, "That is my favorite shirt." And I realized that, like, I have a whole bunch of pictures from different days of him in that same shirt. So it was a good choice. But a lot of the, you know, a lot of the time, you know, in Cuba, for example, when people think that there's a lot of propaganda about what life is like for kids in New York City, that it's very violent, that, you know, that everybody is suffering. And then here, you know, with Elian Gonzalez, and, like, he came here and they wanted to keep him because he was going to starve and be uneducated if he stayed in Cuba. And so, like, there's propaganda on both sides. And so rather than just, like, keep that going, this was an opportunity for the kids to speak for themselves. And also I think that adults, you know, myself included, we have a tendency to kind of want kids to say a specific thing in, you know, pursuit of an end goal of your project. You know, I need you to say something about, you know, how rough this is or how happy this makes you or whatever, you know, and this was just write about yourself, you know, whatever you want to write. So all of my students are ballet dancers. They become ballet dancers. And then I'm also their art teacher, so I have kind of a lot of access to their drawings and their imagination. Also, the school's very small, so I know about their academic life too, and I know their families because I have them from fourth grade through eighth grade. So I took their writings and their drawings and then kind of how I know them and made these paintings that are, you know, hopefully showing a little bit more about who they are and what childhood is like in their own voice. For example, this kid Cyrus, he wrote, "My name is Cyrus. I have these memorized. I talk about these a lot. I'm the only vegetarian in my family. And when I walk to the bus, I watch the birds in the Bronx." And then he said, "My favorite animals are lions, tigers, and monkeys, because although they are vicious creatures, they have a soft side when they get close to a human." Which I don't know if that's true, but I really liked it. This one also, Whitney, she wrote, "My name is Whitney. New York is great because there's so much shopping, food stores, clothes stores, 99-cent stores. But New York is also bad because a lot of people get killed. Besides that, New York is great." And I thought that was really interesting. Just, like, at first I read it and I was kind of horrified because it kind of felt like this is throwing all the materialism of the United States, like, in the face of Cuba. But then afterwards I felt, you know, it's just like, well, this is what she said, so I'm going to paint what she said. And then there was a certain amount of just kind of how used to kids become here of people dying wrongly, you know. So that one was interesting. And I felt like it was the anti-Cuba painting, because in Cuba there's not that much shopping, but there's also not so much violent death. But when I went to Cuba, the kid who kind of identified with her painting was like, "I love shopping too. There's so much shopping in Santiago," and, you know, and it's all, of course, it's all relative. And I hadn't even thought about it because I had looked for Band-Aids one day in Cuba for like 6 hours, and I couldn't find them. So I didn't feel like there was, but he did, you know. So this was the one Times Square painting I did, even though like 20 kids talked about Times Square. This is a girl named Sydney. A lot of the kids wanted to write about the snow because they knew it was something that you don't really have in Cuba. And this is a kid who wrote, these are his drawings from his sketchbook I put on there, but he wrote that he loves to draw and that things are hard at home, but when his mom sees his drawings, she feels happy. So, yeah, and this was also at a time when a friend of mine who's a graffiti artist named Andrea Bernal, she passed away, and that's her tag in the background. So sometimes the paintings would also get filled with other things. This is a kid named Isaac, and he was writing about where he lives. It's really crazy, but you know, this is kind of like this balance. You meet this kid and you think he is the most well-adjusted, friendliest, calmest, happiest kid, and then what he was writing in his postcard was like, it's so noisy where I live, you can't even sleep, and there's a lot of people that get killed in my neighborhood. And so it's, and then my house is noisy because the TV's on and it's a small place. So it was kind of like a balance between who he is in terms of like the spirit that he projects, but also the reality of his situation. And then he always puts the Dominican flag in every single project we've ever done. Could be like a Native American mask and it would have like the, so that was there too. Lydia wrote about being Buddhist and loving animals. There are certain themes that the kids in Cuba really linked onto, and the animals were definitely really popular. And Dimitri, he wrote about being loud and active, which was so such a perfect description of himself. He's very self-aware. A lot of the kids wrote about pizza. This girl, Gabriella, she wrote that there aren't that many words that she likes to say in Spanish, but one word she likes to say is peace, so paz. And she wrote about being from the Dominican Republic. So there are 31 of these paintings. I'm not going to go through everyone so much, but this was Devin at this moment was drawing a lot of rodents in a sketchbook, and he was drawing rats and like moles and rabbits, and it was this odd moment. And but then he did this big project about rabbits, so I kind of focused on the rabbits in his sketchbook. I didn't really want to draw him surrounded by rats. So the show was in April of 2007, and it was at 10 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday, which if it had been here, probably nobody, maybe like three people would have come, but it was Cuba, so it was packed, and there were like 60 kids, and the kids went around the gallery. Well, there were kids that I worked with outside, but the kids went around the gallery and picked the New York City kid who they most closely identified with, this Mauricio's niece, and they wrote a response postcard. So the paintings were exhibited with their postcard, my student's postcard, the writing on the back and the translation. And so the kids were really engaged and just kind of, oftentimes they picked the kid who they most physically resembled, which was interesting, but that was also really cute. And oftentimes, like this girl, her name is Anaïs, she came back to his painting like three times and wrote three different postcards. So there was also a love element, I think, but yeah, so it was interesting to see the paintings that the kids chose, and it was also really nice just to make art with these kids, because I think it has to do with the, I don't necessarily know, but my guess is that it has to do with the lack of digital media that the kids draw so much and so confidently. All the kids that I worked with, I went back with over like 250 postcards from the Cuban kids, and then I started to paint them. And it was a little harder because I didn't know them for so long. You know, I didn't know them well at all. I had had some conversations, but so when I was down there, I was kind of just trying to get an overall essence of what childhood is like in Cuba, and then really stick to what they wrote in their postcards, because I didn't necessarily, a couple of them I knew their families, but not necessarily that many. So this one he wrote to Dimitri, and he also wrote about video games, and it'll be interesting to see what happens with that, because what you feel in Cuba, when at least in my experience, which was also limited, but you feel like a real presence when you're talking to a kid, because they're not texting, they're not thinking about their DS or their Michael Jackson experience or anything. They're like, they're really present with you and not wired the same way anymore. And you know, I don't know if that's why. I'm sure it's a combination of a bunch of factors, but it'll be interesting to see what happens with that. And this is the girl who wrote in response to the postcard to the girl, Sydney, who wrote about Times Square. And so I didn't really want to put in any specific kind of political agenda or anything, but when you look at like the reality of the scenes, like in that scene in the on the left side, it says "En cada barrio revolución," so in every neighborhood revolution, and then the CDR is like the like a very real neighborhood watch group that's countrywide, and so it's kind of like the just the dynamic of the location changes the political context that she's growing up in, and the same with this one where she drew on her postcard these blonde and redheaded white princesses and fairies, which is, you know, what kids do everywhere, what little girls do everywhere, and so I kind of changed those and made them into her. That's like a global thing with little girls, a global problem in my opinion. And this boy, one thing that a lot of kids in Cuba wrote that I love that the U.S. kids do not write is, when I grow up, I want to be a great painter. In the U.S., a lot of the kids write, when I grow up, I want to be rich. I want to be famous. And it was really nice to see that. So this is the son of another painter who also is always drawing. This is Mauricio's niece, Carla, and she, her father is a sculptor, and so I had actually some of his sculptures along the top ribbon, and then his mother does this amazing fabric art, so the whole, you can't really see it from there, but the whole thing is painted as if it's sewn. So I had a show in Brooklyn College, 2009, and the kids came, and it was kind of like with the partner paintings. It was really great to see, especially after being in the prison, just kind of people completely motivated on their ideals and governing themselves autonomously. And the funny thing about this is the door was open because the music was in there, and the favorite song that these guys loved was the Titanic theme song, the Celine Dion song. So they would have me translate it. And these are, you know, guys, like the two that are further away were in the uprising, you know, but they love Celine Dion. So that I thought was really great. But the imagery kind of has, it's a lot of imagery that's specific to the Zapatista movement, like these snails. And then the people in the mountains, they wear this thing called the pasamontaña, which covers their face. And then they all wear bandana. You will never see any pictures of them just head on with no mask. Then I painted Ramona, and that was like me, oh sorry, she was like a hero for me. And she's the one who kind of, in the Zapatista movement, got gender out of, took machismo out of the picture in the Zapatista family. So when you're in the caracol, there men and women cook, men and women chop the wood. There is no disrespecting the woman in a Zapatista home, and so all of their towns that they govern are managed in that way. So she was tiny, but we painted her really huge. And then these are the things that they were asking for: land, work, health, education, healthy food, liberty, communication, culture, production, information, justice, democracy, roof, like housing and peace. So that's what they were fighting for. And now they're kind of at a moment where they're not at battle so much, but they're managing the land that they do have. Although the last day I was in the prison, when I was taking my stuff out, the prisons were put on red alert because there was word that the Zapatistas were having a statewide prison break, which because they what they see is that everybody who's in prison in Mexico is a political prisoner, because they feel like that their lifestyle is conditional because of the state. So that was interesting. Some of these drawings are up here. This was a mural that I did last year at Luther Medical Center. These were some of the drawings that I worked with people in their infectious disease unit about coming up the concept with. This is what ended up being painted. It was kind of small. I painted it at my studio. I really prefer, in general, to paint on location, but sometimes it's nice to work in my studio. And then this was kind of imagery that was inspired by being with the Zapatistas. They often have people growing out of corn, so I made them growing out of plants. This is a mural that I painted with Devin Palmer Krugman, who's right here. And she and another teacher at Acorn, which is in Crown Heights, came, they contacted me last year to do a mural in their classroom. And what I didn't know is what they really wanted was because a lot of people want murals in their classroom. They want to have a picture of the presidents, or they want to have whatever. But what they wanted was to kind of envelop their students in the U.S. history that their students felt was most important. So their students, I workshopped with their students about moments that they felt best represented the essential question that they teach, which is, to what extent has the United States lived up to its founding ideals? So in their students' opinion, very little. It kind of wraps around the room, starting with the Native Americans and the Trail of Tears, and then the kind of decimation of not just the people, but also of the wildlife, and the idea of manifest destiny, delivering all of these travelers westward, slavery. The words that go with these are the words that are kind of keywords for the curriculum. So this is kind of all around them. And what's interesting is that, and I think Devin can speak more on this, but when they have to write essays like for different exams, or they have to present something for different presentations or portfolio reviews, they all choose something now that's a part of the mural, which is nice. And this corner is about rights and loss of civil liberties, and also about the relationship between corporate America and our own loss of privacy and loss of civil liberties. So this was kind of like for my own high school education, which I felt neglected so much of this, it was a very satisfying mural to paint. This is Katrina, kind of just got its own section. And then on the pole, this pole is a kind of resistance pole, and it is full of figures who are not necessarily talked about in the textbooks because they might be considered too radical. So Assata Shakur, Sylvia Rivera, who's like a big transgender rights activist, Leonard Peltier, Sojourner Truth, Harvey Milk, Tommy Jones, Alice Paul. This is a Jesse De La Cruz, who's a United Farm Workers organizer. Pedro Pietri, who's the founder of the New Recon, and John Brown, and Eugene Debs, who I didn't know, he's a big labor leader. So this was just an interesting mural to paint because the students were the ones who kind of came up with the mood of the mural. And they have this section, which is immigration, which is this whole wall, and you know how immigrants were welcomed into Ellis Island and inspected, and they do this project where each student gets a card that says who they are, what country they're from, what their physical state is, if they have any health issues, if they have a limp, if they have what language they speak, and then they made the room be like it was Ellis Island, and it was interesting to kind of see them living out that curriculum, like what we did on the wall, living it out in the classroom, which was really exciting for me because a lot of the time, this was not a mural where after I painted it, I felt like, oh, I should have actually painted something completely different. This was a mural where it felt like the vision of the teachers and the vision of the students and the actual day-to-day activities are all really in tune. This is like the most fun I've ever had right here. This is Sevilla. I was in Sevilla in October, and it was an event called Arte para Todos, Art for All, and the organizers invited 30 artists from 20 countries to go over, and they gave us each a wall. And my wall was the only wall with windows. It was the biggest wall, and it was the only one with windows. And I was, inconveniently, those are bathroom windows, so I felt really embarrassed that, and it also just didn't go with my design because it kind of runs almost right up the middle. So it was an initial extreme frustration, but then these guys from Ukraine, who are amazing painters, they had brought their projection tools. So we just projected, adjusted it, and that was no problem. But the bathroom thing actually became the kind of the best part about the mural because wherever I was on the lift, the people in the building would like pass me coffee or like pass me juice or cookies out the window. And I actually became really good friends with the neighbors because of that. If the windows hadn't been there, I wouldn't have known them as well. So. But this project was really nice because it was kind of like a community of artists. We stayed at the same hotel, and then we would have breakfast together, take the bus together, and everybody had their own walls, all in this same kind of working class neighborhood. And we'd go have lunch together, go back and paint, and then go out for dinner together. And it was kind of like this ideal moment of real camaraderie among artists, which a lot of artists who work like I work, you work by yourself, and then you're usually the only artist. So it was nice, like I learned so much because there's not, this is not something that I don't think yet there's like a real formal study for. And my mural was about displacement and globalization, and the idea was this big girl who's kind of been displaced. I was thinking a lot about Chiapas and like a lot of the communities that I saw that had been displaced, and then these shipping containers kind of as the reason, you know, full of the things that were the reason that she was displaced, and painting the boats kind of relatively small compared to the girl to show that they're almost like, you know, trivial toy boats, because what's inside of these boats is so inconsequential and probably has a shelf life of a year or two, and but the repercussions that it's causing in like places where they find these things that they need to extract from the land and people that they need to remove from their land, so grave. So at the top there's kind of a hidden text from Arundhati Roy, which says either way change is coming, it could be bloody or it could be beautiful, it depends on us. So I wish I would have written it darker. The funny thing about that event was that there were so many graffiti artists who had been invited, and they like couldn't help themselves but tag everything. So all of the lifts were tagged, and the lift people were very nice about it. They didn't really care, but it was something I hadn't really thought about, that all of Sevilla wouldn't just get, like, there were probably 35 murals painted in the couple of weeks. And then besides that, the whole town was tagged. After Sevilla, I went to Barcelona, and there's a housing occupation that's organized by the Zapatistas that in this neighborhood, where the whole time I was in Spain, for maybe the 3.5 weeks or a month before that, I think I'd seen one police the whole time. And then I got to this neighborhood in Barcelona that was the immigrant neighborhood, and it was like all of the cops were there. There were cops on every block, and there were a lot of North African and Middle Eastern and Eastern European immigrants, and it was very heavily criminalized. And so this is a building that a friend of mine, who I actually know from Mexico, she and another group of people had organized in a protest against this slumlord who had kicked out a bunch of people out of their housing. And so they asked me if I would paint a mural on it. So they had been there for a year. They were originally just going to do the protest for an hour, and then they got a lot of legal support, so they just stayed. And they've kind of been organizing a lot of immigration initiatives around it. So they invited me to come and paint, and it was just a one-day project. But it was the most fun day I ever, like, everybody from the occupation and then everybody from that community was kind of so enthusiastic about something for them, because Spain, as much as it looked like it in Sevilla, is not very good in terms of public art, and it's also, in terms of immigrants, really horrible. So this little girl came by with her mom. I was looking for, I finished the big figure at one point, this one, and then this little girl came by. I was thinking I should paint a kid, and I was looking through my camera for a picture of a kid, and then she came by with her mom. She was so perfect, so I asked her mom if I could draw her, and it didn't turn out exactly, but it was really nice because her dad was so excited about it that he owns a fruit market nearby, and now since then, which was in October, every day he brings fruits and vegetables for the people who are in the occupation. So we picked the right girl. And the quote is, Somos la dignidad rebelde, we are the dignified rebellion, which is a Zapatista saying. This guy on the left was the bodyguard for Ramona, the woman that I painted in Mexico. He was her bodyguard when they did this huge march to Mexico City. So and more lately, I think I'm just doing some projects that are fast. This was a two-day project that I did with my friend from Brazil named Issei, and he did the bird in the background and I did the girl. And there's something nice to just having somebody give you a wall and being like, paint whatever you want. So this was just kind of like a fun, no approval necessary thing. And this is what I'm working on right now. This is at Acorn Community High School. I just gave it this title, the Humanities Center for Liberation Pedagogy, because that's what it is. But they didn't have that title. And so when I was putting this slideshow together, I asked the guy if it was okay, and he said that was great. So that's what that is. But I've been working with the teachers on this room that's going to be their center for liberation pedagogy, and In the Clouds are a lot of words that came up workshopping with them about issues that the kids deal with every day. You know, violence, racism, prison industrial complex, family, capitalism, poverty, and then on the built into their clothing is text. It's largely done by Bridget, who's here. She is a text master, so she's been helping me with that. And then it kind of wraps around the quote that's going up. There's some standardized tests on those papers. One says, one is SAT, one is the Regents, one's ASVAB, and it says the greatest, it's a Steve Biko quote, the greatest weapon in the hands of the oppressor is the minds of the oppressed. So it's still in progress. This is a teacher who passed away in the beginning of the year, so it's kind of a way to honor him. And yeah, it's there's going to be a lot of text that's kind of put around, text between the students and the teachers, quotes about different teaching pedagogy. Very quickly, this is my first book. It was not my dream job, but it was my first published book, so that was exciting. And it was about Honda and the man and his life story. I did not write this book, but it was a good challenge for me because it wasn't anything that I was remotely interested in, and I had to bring it to life. And he was an interesting guy. He was very much an innovator. And so that book was released by, this was an ad campaign that Honda put out called You Meet the Nicest People on a Honda for the Super Cub. That's the Super Cub. So that's the first book. This was the second book, which was a book of proverbs from the whole African diaspora. So this was a more of a book for adults. The paintings were black and white, but they kind of tinted them in the book to sepia. And then this is the book that's coming out next year, and it's a true story from my family about a little boy who goes to the internment, and when he gets there, he stops eating because he doesn't like the food, and his brother and his mother really worry about him because he's getting sick, and so his brother thinks back to the night when they came and took his father away, which is what happened to a lot of Japanese men that first night of Pearl Harbor. And so he's, you know, he said, "You're the man of the house, help your mother take care of Jimmy." So in the middle of the night, he snuck out of the barracks and ran shadow to shadow to avoid the rifles, and he cut through the fence and ran up the mountains to a stream where he made his hands into the reeds and let the fish swim into the reeds and caught fish for his brother. So these are just some of the drawings, but that's coming out. And then this, that's coming out in the fall of 2012. And then this is a book that I'm working on about my grandfather, and about it's a biography, and it talks a lot about the Japanese American experience during that time when they weren't allowed to swim in public pools, they weren't allowed to sit in the lower level of the movie theater, and then they were all sent to internment camps during the war, and how he was able to build his career from that. And finally, some of the best work is my students' work. And it's based on a lot of the same principles, you know, of expression, of voice, of kind of spirit and resistance, and also science. I do a lot of projects with the science teachers where they make these monster families where they're studying genetics, so they make a mother monster and a father monster and a Punnett square with dominant recessive traits, and then they pass down the traits to their baby offspring monster. So it's really fun, a monster match. And then also a superhero project where they study, they're superheroes for the environment. So this one is about organic farming, and including like organic meats. That's her belt, and there's corn on her leg, and the cow might see on her foot. But they have to kind of come up with scientific ways that their superhero is good for the environment. I don't know what this one was for, but I liked it. And this one is about something to do with disaster relief of natural disasters. She's got a Red Cross belt on. So I love working with my students. This is my 10th year. And for the first maybe 3 or 4 years of teaching, I was like, I can't do this again. I can't do this. And I felt like to be an artist, you should just be living off of your art. And then in the last, you know, 5 years, I've started just to feel like this, you can't segregate. And I learned this a lot from Marshall, like your teaching and your own work is just part of building a creative life, and what your students do and what you do, it's not all that different. And as much as I kind of give them stuff, they also give me a lot of kind of freedom in my own work. So, and it's just so fun what they make. So that's pretty much it. This is a animals in their habitat. They have to study animal habitats. Finally, this is this bird project. This I keep saying finally because I keep thinking I'm at the end and I'm not. Finally, again, this is a project I did with Cornell's Ornithology Lab, and it was about engaging kids with their urban environment. And I think that this is something I'm more interested in lately, about how to get kids to care about the environment and make it less abstract, and animals is a great way to do that. So I was working with these bird scientists, and their art direction was really funny because they would say things like, I'd submit a drawing, and they'd say, the lower mandible of the brown-headed female cowbird needs to be decurved. And I'd be like, okay. And I actually knew what they meant. So I don't know which bird is which anymore, because I know the pigeon and the duck. But beyond that, I don't remember anymore. But that's it. That's my website. Although you've pretty much seen everything, and that's my email if you'd like to email me. So thank you so much. Does anybody have any questions? Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
I'd like to thank you, first of all.
Oh, sure.
As someone who would describe herself as a person who used to do art, mm-hmm. It's nice to meet someone who, said it was hard to envision yourself as an artist.
Yeah.
And now I'm studying education, so I'm really curious about the mural you did in high school,
mm-hmm.
and what feedback you've gotten since then about the way that students engage with the physical environment and how it assists in their learning of all materials.
I think I'm going to pass that to Devin, because Devin, well, if you have any examples of, and in any way you've used the mural. Devin is a teacher in that classroom, so she's the one who kind of brought me there. So if there's any way, can you think of any way that you've used the mural in your curriculum, or, you use the mural in your curriculum.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I think it's sort of like a hard question to think of the answer to, because it happens, it comes in every single day. There's sort of like the abstract, like somebody will be daydreaming and then like raise their hand, and I think they're asking me about the work that we're doing in that moment, and they're like, that thing over there, like, what is that? I mean, they're very, but like, they're so curious about it, and we just have moments all the time where we're studying something, and they'll see a word or an image, and they're like, oh my God, this is that, like, that's what that is. So it's, I don't know, like,
yeah.
It's sort of that happens accidentally, but we do like gallery walks and around the room where they connect it to like the essential question and to these American ideals, and a lot of them, when they write big essays, they'll choose like the historical topic that the visual images are from to write about.
The other thing I think that I really liked when they approached me to do that mural was that it feels like, everybody else who got that same grant that they did wanted to buy computers. And I think that there's something to not engaging in this competition of digital media. It's very tempting to just be like, okay, kids are tweeting, so let's tweet. Kids use Facebook, so let's reach them there. But it's good to kind of engage them on the flip side of that and just kind of surround them in something that actually makes them stop rather than go faster. And so I think that's what the mural does, is it kind of holds them in their place, and not just kind of in terms of putting them into a past of like, here's history and you're all around, surrounded by history, but you're actually participating in history being made right now by who you are, as a person, as a part of a culture of young people, as a culture of immigrants or whatever, like that they're part of living history. So I think that there's something to just the size and being kind of stopped. It's so frenetic, a lot of the ways that they engage. And so it's, I don't know if you can quantify, I don't know if I can quantify it. There's so much in education now about like quantifying every single thing or recording every single thing, but, and like how you measure if something is being socially transformative. And I think that the only way you can think about it is that like, I'll do the art, Devin will do the teaching, or somebody else does the teaching, Leroux does the university work, and somebody does the law, Chitra does the law stuff, and like somebody's a doctor, and like it's a big part of just a movement, and it, like none of it would ever exist in a bubble, or succeed in a bubble. So, any other, Leroux?
I was really interested in the work you did in the prison in Chiapas. Are you doing any work?
Actually, Leroux gave me this amazing idea that I've kind of been evolving, working on getting together, and Chitra's been helping me now with the second wave of that, which is trying to work with women who are in prison and their children on the outside and have a dialogue, because what struck me so much about that project was how much the women missed and just like had so much they wanted to communicate with their children who were on the outside, and how rot that relationship was. And also knowing kids whose parents are in prison, like how horrible it is when your mother's in jail, you know. So to kind of create a dialogue and have the workshop with the mothers and workshop with the kids, and then paint the mural with the kids on the outside. So that's the idea. Chitra has, or what's the name of the organization?
Steps
in East Harlem. So hopefully something's gonna happen with that. So I have a huge back burner of projects, and that's like in the front of the back burner. I also, there's a couple, like Mencha in the back in the orange sweater, and Casey, Mencha has been the assistant for all of the Voices Heard projects, just so like none of these happen at all by myself. And then Casey is one of the veteran Voices Heard members who just got into San Francisco Institute of Art this week, so.